Hey everybody, it's Matt from Eastwood Company and welcome to another edition of Eastwood Tech Videos. Today we're talking about aluminum welding. There's a bunch of different ways that you can weld aluminum, but today we're going to cover probably the most popular two ways, and that's TIG welding and MIG welding. We're going to start off with the more difficult of the two, TIG welding. TIG welding is a more difficult process. It's sort of like oxyacetylene welding in which you have a torch, a flame, and you have a filler rod that you're adding to it. So before you start welding aluminum with a TIG welder, I highly suggest learning the basics on steel, and then you can start jumping into aluminum. So today, I'm gonna just kind of fast forward and assume or hope that everybody that's watching this at least has a general grasp on how the TIG welding process works. We'll jump right into it. So with TIG welding aluminum, there's a couple key things you need to do that makes you a success, allows you to get a successful TIG weld on aluminum. Probably the number one most important thing is keeping the metal clean, keeping everything clean, really. Aluminum welding and TIG welding in general really needs to be as close to surgically clean as you can get, especially on aluminum. So when you're starting with a fresh piece of metal, this is one that we just have, a brand new piece of metal. You can see on the back side here, it looks pretty darn clean. I mean, there's no huge grease spots on it or anything really offensive on the back of it. But in reality, that's a special coating they put over the top of the metal to keep it from corroding while it's just sitting on the shelves. That coating you cannot TIG weld through. It's gonna cause a dirty weld. It's gonna pop and sputter and cause some issues. So what I've done on the other side here is I've cleaned the metal off. I used just today, really quickly, one of these little angle grinders with a 36 grit on it. If it's something that's a thinner grit or something you don't want to use as aggressive of a sanding disc, you could definitely use a DA sander with 80 grit or 120, or you could, you know, downgrade to a 120 or something for one of these discs. Even one of the little cookies, the like abrasive discs work as well. So I've hit this with the 36 grit. And you can see it's a little bit different of a shade of metal on there. And that's a clean metal. Now what happens is if this metal sits, if we clean this metal and leave it sit for a couple days or if it sits for a month, on the molecular level, this is starting to corrode. It's getting corrosion just from the atmosphere, from the air. Even while I'm holding this, it's happening. Is it enough to cause an issue while we're standing here? Probably not. But if it sits for weeks, months, definitely at that point it could start to cause an issue. So what I always suggest to do, a good tip, is every time before you go to weld aluminum, is take a stainless brush. I like to try and keep a dedicated stainless brush just for aluminum and then a separate one that I would use for steel. This one for aluminum. And I would go over this piece here with the wire brush where we're going to weld, just to knock any potential corrosion that got on the surface just from, you know, when it's sitting around, or potentially if something just got on, you dropped on your workbench or something dirty there, you can take any of that off. So that's how to prepare the piece, a real quick way. If you want to really get it as clean as possible, the pre-painting prep, our low VOC, that's the key thing that I do want to mention. You want to use our low VOC pre-painting prep, where you can use straight acetone or simple green or something like that to clean your part. Do not, under any circumstances, use a heavy-duty cleaner like a brake clean or a chassis clean or something that's aggressive like that, a carb clean. They have an ingredient in them that leaves a residue on the metal that even after you wipe it off and let it flash off, there's a residue that could potentially be on the metal. When you burn, where you start melting the metal, it burns that residue and it creates basically what is mustard gas. So it's obviously very harmful. Don't want to breathe that in. So if you make sure you use a low VOC formula like the pre, straight acetone, or simple green or something like that, a less aggressive cleaner, those ones are all okay and they'll flash off and it'll be just fine. So again, that's cleaning it. So TIG welding aluminum, there's a couple key things. With TIG welding aluminum, you do need to use 100% argon. Pretty much all TIG welding, you need to use 100% argon. The other thing is, you're going to flip your machine. If you have an Eastwood machine, right here, this switch here, you're going to flip it over to the AC side. You should be familiar with the amperage here, your pre and your post flow. I like to crank the pre flow up a little bit higher, and the post flow I like to crank a little bit higher as well. So I have that turned up a bit from where I would weld on steel. The reason being is that with aluminum, it has a lower melting temperature. It's going to solidify a little slower. You need to keep your torch, and we'll show you in a little bit, held over the area of the last dab of weld that you put in. You need to hold your torch over for the post flow to allow that metal to cool, solidify, and you keep a little bubble of shielding gas around it. So that's why that's really important to make sure that your post flow is turned up a little bit. The other dial that's pretty important here is the clearance effect. Some machines may call this a balance control. On our machine, it's called a clearance effect. Essentially, what you're doing in a short version of this, you're changing the sine wave that's coming out of the machine, going from positive and negative. There's a sine wave that's going up and down. By playing with this dial, you can basically make the sine wave hang to the positive or the negative side. So it can hang for a split second or two longer. What this means to you, why you care, that basically changes how much, it changes the size of your puddle and how much the machine actually cleans, how much the torch cleans. So when you're welding aluminum, there's an additional process that does not happen in steel, on which it's actually cleaning the metal before you start actually adding filler rod to it. So with this, by turning it more negative, you're going to get a narrower, more narrow puddle that's going to clean less. So the more negative it is, the less cleaning you're going to get. The more you turn it towards the positive side, the more your puddle is going to get wider, but you're going to get a larger cleaning area. This is important if you're welding different types of aluminum. If you're welding a part that's actually on a car, that was on a car, it may just be a casting that's a more dirty aluminum. The way I always describe it is, if you're welding a part that's off of a 1920s car, a piece of aluminum that's from 1920s, they obviously used a much poorer quality than if you were welding something that was from, a 2010 Mercedes. They're going to use a lot nicer aluminum. So you may have to change your clearance effect or your balance control to compensate for the quality of the metal. So with what we're welding today, this is fresh, clean aluminum. I'm using what's called a gas lens here. Let me just pull my torch out. So I'm using a gas lens setup, which uses a little screen on the inside. This gas lens setup is much more efficient with the gas coverage, the shielding gas coverage over the area that you weld, which means that you can get away with, which means it cleans better, and you can get away with running a little more towards the negative side when you're welding aluminum. So for this, what we're welding today, I'm going to stick to -3 for the clearance effect. I could probably even drop a little bit lower if I wanted to. But for what we're doing today, that's a nice safe spot. So we've got this all set up. We'll check our cords here, make sure everything's tight. We got all that good. All right. So we have our argon, like I said, 100% argon set up. And I'm going to put on some safety equipment here, the helmet and the gloves, and I'll flip the machine on. And we're just going to show you the process for TIG welding. I'm going to try and talk you through it as we're doing it, because I feel that it's better to kind of see rather than listening to me go on and on about it. I think you guys can learn a little bit by just watching the process and seeing what it's supposed to look like. So we'll get our gloves on here. Now you want to match your filler rod as close as you can to what you're welding. The filler rod that we offer is a 4000 series, so it's a ER4043. So that's a type of aluminum. Any TIG wire that you get is going to have the type of filler material that it is on the top there. So an ER4043 is a good all-around filler wire. You can use this for most all repairs. You're pretty safe with using. Now there is going to be instances where you may have something that's a much different grade of aluminum that you may have to upgrade, or upgrade your filler wire to match more closely what you're welding. So we got a shielding gas on, and I'm gonna sit down here. So before I actually start welding, I'll show you. So what you're going to want to do, move this all over here. When you start welding, we're going to actually hold our hand, our torch, in the same spot for a beat or two, for a second, a couple seconds. We're going to let the torch clean the metal really well. You'll see that there'll be like a white halo that will kind of, the arc will dance around and kind of put a white halo around where we're welding. Once you see that forming, then you can start giving it a little more throttle, a little more pedal, a little more amperage, and you'll start to see a shiny puddle open up. Once you start to see that shiny puddle open up, that's when you're about ready to add filler rod. A common mistake that we see people make is that they, as soon as they start the arc, they start adding filler rod. With TIG welding, you need to kind of wait, let that puddle open up, then you can add your filler rod and start moving. So I'm gonna be clean. All right. So let me just start here, and then I'll kind of talk you through it. You let me know when you're ready, Joe. So as you can see, it's kind of dancing around there. I'm giving it more throttle. It's getting a little shiny there. Now I can add my filler rod. I'm just adding filler rod and moving. You can see that white halo is kind of following where I'm welding. And I am pumping the pedal a little bit. That's to kind of keep my heat in check. With aluminum being such a heat sink, I definitely want to make sure that the piece doesn't get too hot and we don't blow through. So I'm just kind of going along. And that's why you hear that amperage. The sound is kind of changing as I vary the amperage of my foot. All right, now here at the end, I'm going to back off real slow. Add one last dab of filler. Another one. Hold my torch over there. Hear it. Now, once you hear that stop, that's when you can let off. So we had a little bit of a brown halo that you see there at the end. That means that there was a little bit of contaminant on this. It could have been just from my fingers touching this. There could have been a little bit that showed up at the end. So again, if you really, really, really clean the part and you're religious with it, you can really get a surgically clean piece, and you won't get that little brown halo there. For what we were doing here, I probably should have just wiped it off, but it doesn't hurt anything, you know, again, for just demonstrating the process. But you can see on this piece here, can you see that? Or I'll flip it up here. You can see the white halo that's kind of around our whole entire weld. That's the cleaning area that we were talking about. So if we turn the setting, if we turn that setting up more towards the positive side, so if we go from -3 to say -1, this puddle is going to open up quite a bit, and you're going to see that halo open up quite a bit as well. So that's the you have to play with that dial to get the sweet spot as you're learning. So that's the basics to TIG welding aluminum. Hopefully, if you follow some of these little tips and tricks I gave, some of the steps, it can help jumpstart you into laying some really nice aluminum welds. The most important thing is that you need to practice. Practice, practice, practice. That's probably the most important thing with TIG welding in general, especially aluminum. Start practicing on your own before you actually start welding something that you care about. So thanks for watching. If you have any ideas for future tech videos or anything else you'd like to learn from us, feel free to leave us a comment in the video comments section. Make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel to get updates on everything that's Eastwood. And follow us on all our other social media outlets, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, @EastwoodCo. Thanks for watching, and we'll catch you next time.